Hi, I'm Simone Heng, and you're watching Anything is Possible with Decentric Media.
I'm Patrick Tsang, global citizen, investor. Join me as I talk with global influencers for their insight, wisdom, and how they overcame their own personal challenges. Sharing positivity, overcoming challenges, creating one world together. I'm Patrick Tsang. Anything is possible. Hi, everyone. Welcome to another episode of Anything is Possible. I have a special guest, a very smart, beautiful young lady from Singapore, Miss Simone Heng. She's a human connection specialist. She's been all across the globe. Very excited to have her here with me because she shares something in common with me. She's a global citizen. She's multicultural. And she bridges east to west, which is what I'm all about. And Simone, very happy to see you. And you, we had some technical difficulties earlier, but we're here.
It was tech gate, but we're out of the gate right now. So it's all good. It's all good. Patrick, thank you so much for reaching out. And I'm absolutely so excited because the lineup of the people you had in season one just was so impressive and the quality of what you're doing. And so I'm very, very excited to be able to help people and add value today.
So during this COVID year or COVID years, I would say, tell us about your experience of 2020.
Wow. I look back on 2020 now and I realize that beginning with the global lockdown, I was actually in fight or flight basically for most of the year, trying to make sure that my business survived and also trying to really ride the wave of the human connection need that was happening because of COVID and as a result of social distancing. So just to contextualize, I had been speaking and researching on the topic of human connection since the beginning of 2019, first on the side of my full-time job in broadcasting and then full-time as a speaker. And I really saw that people were very much in need during this time. And it was time for me to very much step up. And the internet was the only way to do it. And at the time that COVID hit, I was not yet living with my partner. So I was alone in a one bedroom flat, experiencing the social distancing and the isolation at the same time as creating the content about it. And I think that that is something that's really quite was very fascinating. So yes, fight or flight, but then because I think I am such a migrant kid, I just have this grit that ended up making it a very, very prosperous and lucrative year for me. And I say that obviously not taking anything away from the experience of the people that have had a really tough year, but I've had previous tough years in my life as we'll talk about after this. So I think it's okay to now that 2020 is over to claim that I'm really proud of how the company and how I managed to get through the year, but it was an out of body experience as it was for most people. But I look back now and I think, how on earth did I manage to get all of that done? And that was as a result basically of kind of being in a sort of fight or flight the whole time.
Absolutely. So as you know, COVID has disrupted many people's lives. In the US alone, we have, 30 million people unemployed. They have a lot of, social disruption because of political events as well. What kind of advice would you give to the younger people right now?
So I would say the internet is your best friend. I have a friend who literally went to launch her speaking business after working full-time in a job at the height of the global lockdown. She has now been featured in the New York Times because she used TikTok to go viral and was featured everywhere. So if you think I had a good 2020 and made the most of the internet, I was kind of doing content, but at the same time doing a lot of online speeches. For her, they were in complete lockdown in Melbourne. And she was able to use the apps on her phone to create connection, even though it was virtual. That's all we had, but create connection in a time where there was a great thirst for connection. And so if you can get online and you can make content representing your mission, whether it be on LinkedIn, TikTok, Instagram, YouTube, or do what Patrick's doing right now, create your own series, do it in a way that helps others. And I'm going to tell you, you're never going to get better traction right now. And it can lead to maybe featuring the New York Times, which leads to a job. Maybe it helps you to get more traction and momentum in your own personal esteem. Because what happens when we're out of work, when we feel we're not in demand, we feel we lose significance, we're struggling, we're in fight or flight, we're feeling social isolation, it's very easy to slip from those places. And the only way you get momentum in your personal life or your career is by doing. So just even if the first video is hopeless, even if the first podcast makes you cringe, just do it. No one has to see the first episode. Build those skills, because the action of doing will give you more hope than staying static.
Absolutely, Simone. One of my role models is Bruce Lee. He talks about knowing is not enough. We must do. So Absolutely, action is paramount. So let's get to know Simone a little bit more for the audience. So you're obviously a very outgoing, energetic, positive person. Maybe you weren't when you were a child. So let's talk about your childhood. How would you describe yourself as a child?
So I feel now at 36 that I'm much more similar to what I was as a kid. I grew up as a Singaporean migrant child in Australia. I was born here in Singapore, where I now live. And my parents chose to immigrate with us when I was three. And my father was a shopkeeper and worked his butt off. So very, very early on, I saw the value in hard work. And I would sit behind my dad's counter at his news agency, and I would watch him talk to British immigrants in Australia, talk to Greeks, Italians, people of all colors, and really pivot his communication to connect with these people. And I think that's the first part of my life where I observed how powerful it could be if you were a strong communicator. And also watched my dad work 7 days a week till he passed away at the age of 60. And so a big part of the Simone that is now, or oh God, I don't mean to be talking about myself in third person, how awful does that sound? But the person that I am now is as a result of watching that kind of migrant grit and that determination to build a dream for his family. It's the same way I build the dream for what I want now, is relentless. People are always like, how do you, with a 1+1 business model, create this factory, this engine of content? And it's because I'm relentless. So I was still relentless as a child, but very hardworking, very fun, but very, very ambitious always from day dot. And watching my parents. My mum is a tiger mother. I'm sure every Asian girl says that, but just to contextualize, my mum is mixed race from Singapore. So she actually presents as white. She looks white, green eyes, light hair, but she speaks with a thick Singaporean accent, and she's mixed race from Singapore. And she was a mentor and a teacher at Singapore's most elite girls' school, and was basically instrumental in educating a group of young women who are now like the CFOs of major banks and community leaders. And so she bought that fierceness and that devotion to education into the household. So I had hard work from my dad, who wasn't educated, and then this focus on education for my mum. And the two of these things came together to push my sister and I so much beyond, I guess, what my parents perceived their generation could have in Australia as migrants. And I think it was quite upsetting for my mum when I came back to Singapore, but that's a story for another day. But interestingly, after my dad died when I was 19, I started to be aware, I think, of that there were other ways to be in the world. I'd gotten a scholarship to study in Switzerland, and I'd lived with other families, and I started to become aware of kind of my appearance. And I think that is where, when I was in entertainment, I lost myself for a long time, because actually at the foundation of who I am, which is why I'm so happy now, is a focus on connection, a focus on education, a focus on grit. These are my like three major values, and you see them on social media everywhere. And it was actually more uncomfortable for me not to be like that than to just be true to myself like I am now. So that's a bit of the journey, and I tried to truncate it.
It's a great story, Simone. I mean, relentless ambition, drive, grit are all, common ingredients of all, people who try to succeed, not just in their career, but also in life as well. So, I've also, done a lot of research, listened to a lot of your content. And I understand you have a sister, and then you are in a way like competing. Can you tell us about the relationship of your sister and how that molded who you are today?
Sure. So I'll start by telling you a parable that I learned about in Chinese school when I was a little girl, about in China, in ancient China, every year they would have, and it explains my sister and I, they would have a massive China-wide exam This is in the Mulan era. I want everyone to visualize how long ago this was. This is like Confucian times. So each village would put forward their best scholar to sit at this exam, and it was the pride of the village for their scholar to succeed. So once the scholar was chosen, everybody else in the village had to contribute to doing his housework, his meals, helping his family so that they could he could win and be the best in this exam. And that was very much what I experienced. And I see it all the time now. I live back in Singapore, but in Australia, it was strange that in the house, my sister was 2 years ahead. So when she was sitting her A-level exam, it was obviously more important than my exam because I was 2 years younger. So I would have to do all, pick up her slack of her chores, do whatever I had to do extra so that she could do well in these exams. But because I was the youngest, my day never came where somebody got me, helped me with all the things for my exam. So I think there was a little bit of resentment there. Also because it was very often talked about in my house. My mum would often talk about with the aunties about which kid got what score. And I know this might seem like borderline child abuse to my Western girlfriends, but it was very, very normal in our community that everyone's TER scores would be compared. And, you know, it was just very, very normal. And so that pressure was almost always subconscious. But the wonderful thing is now she has gone such a different way. She's the partner in a law firm in Australia and very, very successful, made partner at 32 in a largely white Australian male landscape. And I'm so, so proud of her. And now we're just in such disparate fields that you would never think. But one thing that she and I always go back to is how grateful we are about mum's focus on education, because my dad's family, we're actually from very, very humble beginnings. And I know that very confrontationally as I now live in Singapore. There's a lot of trauma, a lot of, you know, sadness in both sides of my family. But we don't come from money is what I'm trying to say. But education allows people to leapfrog in a generation. And that's what we see with the Chinese diaspora. We see that with the Indian diaspora around the world. And so don't take lightly your education. And by that, I don't mean Ivy League. I mean even as simple as reskilling yourself with courses you can do on the side of your job. If you are in a COVID situation right now where all you've got is time, I can tell you right now, I'm doing a Harvard rhetoric course online that costs me $0. So if you are focused, if you have grit, if you have ambition, and you have time right now, you can walk out of COVID and go into your next job interview with 4 or 5 Ivy League courses that you didn't pay for on your CV to show that you utilize this time to a prospective employer. And I think that that is incredible about the world we live in right now.
Super advice, Simone. There's a lot of, you know, points to talk about just there. I share with you that, you know, coming from an Asian upbringing, you know, education is key. Education is very dear to my heart. You know, we're trying to do a lot more to give back, and that's part of the objective of the show here. So did that have any bearing into the expectations that your parents have had for you, you know, from your dad and also from your mom, especially she comes from like a, you know, a elite school kind of background?
Yeah, look, so my dad was very humble, didn't have a higher education. And so he was very encouraging of the things that I did in the arts. So I'm very, very creative. And he was very encouraging of that. But I think what both of my parents shared in common, there was pressure, of course, from my mum, but what both of them knew was that education is the ultimate gift because no one can take it away from you. It's one of the few things that if you give a child great education, people can dog them down. Life can throw things at you, but you carry that here. No one can take away your great mind, you know? So I think that that was something that they knew. And another thing that was a byproduct of the pressure, right? There was so much pressure that I remember getting like 98 on an English literature exam and my mum forcing me to go back in and ask the literature teacher like where I lost the 2 marks, because my mum was a literature teacher. So language for us is very, very dear. And she just thought it was, you know, where did I lose these marks? So she asked me to go and ask. And I remember bursting into tears in front of Mrs. Moray, my year 8 English teacher, and not realizing that I felt that pressured until I burst into tears. So I think it's something that Asian migrant kids or Asian kids in general just chronically carry with them. But I look back now and I think why education is the second reason it's an incredible gift is that Asian parenting, you will never be affirmed by your parents verbally. They will never say, Simone, you're very pretty. You're so talented. You're so intelligent. Patrick, you're so clever. They might boast about you when you're not around to hear, but they will never directly affirm you. And what that means as a child is that you have to go into the schoolyard and you have to get affirmation, a temperature gauge that you have aptitude in something by actually getting good grades in it. That's the only real way, because you're never going to hear it. Like my Western friends growing up would get, my child is so talented, you're all this affirmation, which I never got. And I realized the reason my mother and father gave that gift to me is so that any time during life where I didn't feel good about myself or my confidence was lapsing, I literally just had to go and do one thing that I had aptitude in. So in COVID, I'm feeling down. What did I do? I painted an entire art exhibition because I know I've got some aptitude there. I wrote articles for Thrive on human connection. I submitted them for publishing because work was very quiet. And it gave me the boost. The reception to those creations gave me the confidence boost I needed to get through COVID. So education is the ultimate gift because it does not rely on external affirmation from people. Like you don't need those comments. You can just go and do something you're good at anytime as an adult and get that feeling of confidence again. So I think it's the gift that keeps on giving. But yes, the short answer is, Patrick, yes, I felt pressure as a kid. There's no doubt. And I felt a lot of pressure when I decided not to become a doctor or a lawyer, like, or even a news broadcaster, which funnily enough is happening now. You know, I do some reporting for CNBC and I do do bits and pieces here of more corporate broadcasting work now that I've left radio. So it has happened anyway, but I think my mum was just heartbroken that I went back to Asia firstly, after they spent so much effort trying to migrate, and just a lot of pressure to be doing a job that they approved of. But I think I just have this internal voice that I always knew I wouldn't be happy doing that.
Understand. And obviously you moved. I'd like to know a little bit about, you know, what, if it's not too personal, what was the reason for your parents to leave Singapore for Australia?
Sure. I think it's because my mum, having worked in the education system, and this is ironic to the story I tell you, you know, everything is relative. Yes, my mum was very draconian in the Australian context, but in the Singaporean context, she had seen the pressure, I think, that young women or students go through in the Singapore system, and wanted us to have a more holistic education with exposure to the arts, exposure to sport, things like that. And I think that was her primary reasoning at the time. She also knew at the major reason as well, is at the time, and Singapore still has this rule, if you're a mixed race child in Singapore, you're written down on your IC card as the race of your father. So I'd be considered Chinese. And that would mean that the ruling would be that at school, I would have to have Mandarin as a second language, which would be assessed. But my father only could speak dialects, couldn't even write Mandarin. And of course, my mother couldn't either. So she knew that we would never be able to get the grades in that amongst obviously Chinese students to be able to get into a university. I mean, maybe she didn't have enough faith in us, but she knew that it would be an uphill battle with that component of the education system. So whatever race your father was, you had to do that language at school. And she knew we would fail. She's not wrong. My Mandarin is still terrible.
Was your mum against you moving back to Singapore?
Yeah, she didn't. So my father died in 2004 and I moved to Singapore midway. I went back and finished my degree, but at the time I left midway after my father died, 2005, middle of 2005, I came to Singapore. So just over a year after he passed away, and she stopped talking to me for 6 months. For her, it was the ultimate betrayal that, you know, I've lost my husband and you're not staying here and finishing your degree. But watching my father literally pass away in front of me was the biggest catalyst to realize that life is finite. In that moment, I really grew up and I was daddy's girl, you know, and I think he had really protected me, and that shattered. And I remember thinking, I don't want to work at a job for 7 days a week and never see my retirement. I want to live my retirement now. And by that, I mean, I want to enjoy my job. And I knew that in the Australian environment, I would never be able to do the kind of work in the media I wanted, because in the year 2004, you know, women that look like me were not considered attractive in Australia. The paradigm is changing now a little bit, but it was largely blonde hair, blue eyes was the thing. And so I knew being frontline was just not going to be a possibility unless I worked for 20 years as like an intern behind the scenes until I finally got on camera. And I just didn't feel with seeing what I just seen with my dad that I wanted to go down that road.
Understand. And then how did the whole broadcasting dream come about?
Sure. So I did communications at university, then came to Singapore to do an internship at a radio station and met someone there who ended up becoming a former colleague 15 years later, met someone there who introduced me to Channel V in Malaysia. And they screen tested me, flew me to Malaysia while I was on the internship, screen tested me, and I got the job. And then I was a VJ with them, and it went really badly for about 3 months, and I didn't make it any further than that. But shortly after that, I got a gig with HBO Asia and a job on the radio. So I would shoot HBO on the weekend and the radio during the week. And then after 8 months of that radio station, Virgin, Richard Branson's Virgin Radio were building a station in Dubai, and they emailed me. So I've been really, really lucky. I don't know many people who get to be frontline at, you know, Australia, Dubai, Singapore in media. And that is probably for me the biggest badge that I am actually a global citizen, because radio is a notoriously local medium. So if you can make people in different cities that you don't even belong to, feel like you know them, you understand them, you're on their wavelength. That is exactly what my father did in, I'm going to cry now, in that news agency, standing behind the counter, talking to all those people from different backgrounds. It's pivoting your communication and being nuanced in how you connect with people. So yeah, I've been very lucky, very lucky.
Super to hear, Simone. I think, you know, sometimes, you know, a lot of us create our own luck. So can you tell the audience a bit about your experience of living in different places like Australia, Dubai, Singapore, and how that's shaped, you know, you and who you are today?
Yeah, absolutely. So my first experience living long-term in a country was a scholarship I got to Switzerland when I was 17, and I had to learn German and live with families that spoke Swiss dialect. It was terrifying. But one thing that I really realized the difference was that I had grown up in a microcosm of immigrants where things were just very different. So my Swiss families, they were not highly, they were not loud. There was no shouting in the house, like an Asian house. It was very, very quiet, demure. And the attitude toward food was different. I can tell you one story that I had invited one of my friends from school back to one of my host family's house for dinner. And I was just used to living in a house where there was just so much food that I didn't tell my host parents in advance. And then after my friend left, my host mother said, Simone, and she said it in German, it freaked me out. Simone, if you are going to invite somebody to the house, you must let us know in advance. She had to halve my host father's steak for my friend. And that's when I realized, oh, Western people, Europeans in that part of Europe, they order one piece per person. They don't have all this extra wastage food like we do as Asians. And what that really told me at a very young age at 17 was like, if this is different for you, how much else do you not know? What else is out there? If this one small incident is an indicator that you have grown up in a bubble, do you not want the whole world now to be your bubble? Don't you now want to see it all? And I think that that is what happened. And when I went back to Australia, I could not rest until I could find another way to go and learn more about how other people lived. But then my dad died. And so that put that on a bit of a back burner. And then I came to Singapore, and then Dubai happened, right? So Dubai was 5 incredible years of feeling extremely comfortable in who I was. Now, prior to that, I'd been in Singapore, and it's very, Patrick can attest this, when you live in Asia and you're slightly mixed race, you're not fully like Han Chinese looking, you will be asked a million times, where are you from? Why is your accent like this? Oh, you look mixed. And you're constantly having this conversation. And to be honest, I would have that conversation in Australia too in the 90s, like explaining where my family's from all the time. And Dubai is this place where no one has that preamble conversation. Everybody is from somewhere with mixed parents, grown up here, speaks these languages. And so you can just get right to the guts of a great conversation. You're not held hostage to that. And that is one of the most beautiful things about Dubai that I don't think enough people talk about and enough people aren't grateful for until they leave that city.
Anyway, moving on to a more sexy story. So you obviously moved to Dubai. You were working for Virgin Radio under Richard Branson. Tell us about the experience at Virgin Radio and Richard Branson.
Well, starting off with Richard Branson, I got to meet him once during my time there. We were broadcasting on the top of the Burj Khalifa for the world's tallest radio broadcast. And just humble, like so humble. And I think I was at a point in my life where I just was like I was like a Justin Bieber idiot, like just a little bit full of myself maybe. And his humility was really, you know, a good mirror to hold up to myself. If someone in that level can be so humble, then I needed to check myself. So it was a good wake up call. So that was part of it. I mean, Virgin Radio in terms of the company's values, in terms of allowing people to create and creativity and freedom and a maverick behavior, anti-authoritarian behavior, was part of the company DNA. And I didn't realize how different that would be to companies I went to work for later, but I knew something special was happening at that time because we were the first radio team there. We were kids in our early 20s. They were paying us maybe three times more than what radio announcers were getting of our age in other markets. And it was just a beautiful time to be creative. It was also very stressful too. But when you're in your 20s, early 20s, you can handle that level of stress. And it was kind of a crucible for lots of creative people, like a few of the people that were my counterparts at that time, my age. One of them, Huda Katan, has Huda Beauty now, and she is like a billionaire. Another girl called Supercar Blondie is like doing all this content online, is really well known. So a lot of the girls my age from that time, that my time in Dubai introduced me to, everyone was just creating. And that's to do with the city also being very entrepreneurial. So even when I was working for Virgin, because Virgin was started by one of the world's most famous entrepreneurs, they encouraged our entrepreneurship. So we would be allowed to moonlight and be club DJs or have fashion blogs or do TV. They just allowed us to do that. And the city was tax-free. So for me, I had heard so many horror stories about going to Dubai, people going to Dubai, young people spending a lot of money, not bringing anything home. So with my Dubai money, I saved everything up and I bought my first property when I went back to Australia by the ocean. And for me, that was, you know, that's, I think, what migrant parents in Australia just want for their kids. I think my parents are like, just let her have a property and then she's safe and that's all we need. And so I'm really glad I worked as hard as I did.
Super. And then you also moved on from, you know, being a broadcaster and now you're doing a lot of speaking, motivational, thought leadership. Can you tell us a bit about your first keynote?
So firstly, I speak on the topic of human connection. And at the beginning of the speaking journey, as I was developing the research for that, people would ask me to speak at like women's events. And so it was International Women's Day 2018, and I was only still researching human connection. It wasn't a topic yet. And M Group, big marketing group, asked me to come in and speak about, you know, women's empowerment. It's cliched now because of cultural things that have happened, but at the time it was still post Me Too, it was hot topic. And I was terrified. I would spend days and days practicing this keynote and wasn't really sure of the content. And I think that that's something that people need to understand about speaking. When you get asked to speak, your message is first. So what are you known for? You have to have a topic that you're known for. And then you get asked to speak, not the other way around. Because I get a lot of young people asking me, how do I become a speaker? How do I get paid five figures to speak? You know, what topic should I have? And it's not about that. It's what message resonates with you. What are you going to work on for 20 years? And at the time, that wasn't the case. So I'm there just happy to have my very first paid speaking gig. I think they're giving me like $1,500, okay? Not like nothing. And so I interviewed my sister as one of the case studies. I interviewed my mum to get, you know, information about girls that she'd mentored. And after the keynote, I got sick, Patrick, because this is the thing, when you birth something truly creative, okay? Not something that's slapdash rushed, but content that is really challenging for you. The very first time you create it, it is exhausting. And I've just submitted a pilot for Audible, and we've gotten funding for the pilot. So I'm really excited. But the first time ever writing an audio script, I was sleepless. I was exhausted afterwards. I almost got sick. And I think that that is where I really realized what it is to be a creative. So not just as a speaker, but as a creative, like it should exhaust you versus going on air every night, the radio, and just pumping out mediocre, apathetic, uninspiring work that doesn't add value. That is fine when you're younger, but after you do that for 10 years, you really would rather do quality versus quantity. And that's how I knew, oh, wow, Simone, you're growing as a creative because your work makes you sleepless. That means that you have so much skin in the game. So that was the first keynote, and that is a little bit of takeaways for anyone who's currently looking for inspiration during COVID and not finding it.
It's very inspiring, Simone. I agree with that. I think it just defines who you are. It's passion. You know, if you're passionate about something, then you do whatever it takes. You don't sleep, you don't eat, you get sick, you're willing to get sick to do this. So that's very important. So one of your talks was at Google, and that went very successful, went viral. Tell us a bit about that experience.
So this was probably the first speech where I didn't cringe at the content because I knew the content so well. It was my story, and no one can argue with your story. It's your story. So they wrote to me on Instagram and just saw that I'd been putting up small 1 minute clips of the good parts of the bad speeches I was doing because the rest of the speech was terrible. So I would just put the 1 minute good nugget online, and they wrote to me and they said they had a women's event and the theme was stepping up and could I come and speak? And this is still while I'm researching human connection in the background. And I went up and I remember writing that speech from my mouth, not even on paper, word for word, it came out of me. And I think sometimes when you hear songwriters talk about that, like I wrote this song in a lunch break. There's sometimes things that have been brewing in us for years and years and years that are begging to inhabit space.
You've started something called Courageous Speaking. Can you tell us about the mission and the goal of this?
Yeah. So during the height of COVID, I was getting more and more workshops from corporations asking me to deliver on how to connect on camera. And I realized that there is a whole bunch of people around Southeast Asia who have been displaced by COVID, who need to do job interviews online, need to connect on camera because they're unemployed or they've just graduated. And they also don't have thousands of dollars like a corporation to bring me in. So I realized what that actually was knowledge becoming held by people who had money and it not being made available to people who are being hard done by during COVID. And that gap would just widen. So I wanted to democratize that information and just give it away at a price that everyone could afford. So for $15 a month, people can get the same expert knowledge that is being given to executives at corporations delivered to them in this private Facebook group. And yeah, it's just incredible. The community has 150 people now, and we're hopefully going to grow it more and more and more. And it's just, you know, we have people from the Philippines, people from Indonesia, people from India, Australia, people that really, you know, you one-on-one coaching as well is thousands of dollars. People who don't have access, cannot get access to that. So I think it's been really lovely for me because actually after you count my time, Patrick, it's not something that I do that is hugely profit-making. The money from it just covers my assistant who can maintain the Facebook and do all of that. But it's allowing people to get access to information.
You were, and this is not a criticism of you. We all have we're all guilty of this, is we always try to, I guess, when we're younger, we pretend to be someone we're not. Mm-hmm. And so I wanted to talk about, you know, honesty and expressing the truth. What's the value of telling the truth, and, you know, how does one go about doing this?
I can tell you that firstly, when you speak your truth story, that doesn't necessarily frame you in the perfect light and make you all rosy and Instagram-y to people. When you when you're truthful like that, firstly with yourself in private, you connect with yourself much more profoundly. When you connect with yourself profoundly, you have great self-connection, your relationships and your connections with everybody else improve profoundly. And when you improve your relationships externally profoundly, that's where you get actually what you want by pretending your life is rosy. You build reputation. And like most people see how much my life has changed simply by the act of connecting truthfully with my vulnerability, with who I am, the ugly parts of me, warts and all, versus what I tried to do in my 20s and pretend that everything was perfect. And I couldn't keep a lid on it anymore because I knew there was so much trauma in the family life and all this stuff going on. I just had to be honest. Once I got honest with myself, I became so much more comfortable around other people. And that ease, when other people feel that confidence, but that ease, that warmth and confidence together, it becomes almost magnetic. And, you know, when you're magnetic like that, opportunities just open up to you. So that's the value. I know that's pseudo-spiritual, but I can only tell it to you from someone who's lived it. And that's the best I can articulate it.
So you also recently did a video on life purpose. Can you tell us about what your life purpose is and what kind of like advice you would share with some of our audience?
Wow, Patrick, you really are watching all the videos. This is incredible. So I did a story about life purpose, about when I was really, really struggling. I repatriated from Dubai to Australia in 2014 after my mum had this huge stroke that put her in a wheelchair. And I was really struggling. My mum was an Asian hoarder and I had to clean 70 years worth of her and my father's stuff that they'd filled in this house. And so I left my job on Australian radio and I was doing this. And so essentially for 6 months, I became a cleaner. And I always say there's absolutely nothing wrong with that, but it's not what I was born to do on this planet. It's not what I studied or what I have aptitude in. And so I really lost all of those things that we mentioned before about getting confidence by doing things you have aptitude in. I was at the point where I was even losing the motivation to even do things that I had aptitude in. Like I couldn't fight it anymore. And I wondered whether maybe that was depression. Was I depressed? And so I went to the doctor, the GP, and I was having outbursts. Like I had a lot of anger at a lot of the things that I was finding in my mum's hoard, discovering family secrets and things like that. And I had a lot of rage. And so I went to the doctor, my local GP, and he asked me to fill out a depression survey. And the questions were like, do you want to get up in the morning, or do you feel sad for no reason? Things like this. And I gave the survey to him and he looked at me and he checked the results. And he said, Simone, you know, you're not depressed. You just need to go back to a place where you can live your life's purpose. And he said, I'm going to give you a book and I want you to read this book. And this book is your medicine. And so I drove to the bookstore when there were still bookstores. And I read that book cover to cover that evening. And the book was Man's Search for Meaning by Viktor Frankl. And at this point, I just thought that I was being very vain and I had a lot of self-loathing, that maybe I just couldn't cope without having a profile, or maybe I just was silly that I thought that not having a, I didn't realize how important having a purpose was. And this is before purpose became part of this global rhetoric. So I then read this book and Viktor Frankl states in the book that the people that survived the camps are the ones that had a purpose beyond themselves to live. So this is not a vanity purpose. This is a purpose to impact the world, or to care for your children or your partner. You know, it's big. And when I read it, I realized, like, this thing that I thought I was being vain over is actually, for my personality type, part of my lifeblood. So I then got in contact with a friend and got a recommendation and got a job in Singapore and an employment pass. And after I settled mum's things, moved back out to Asia. And the beginning was tough, but finally and slowly got back to my purpose.
Very inspiring. It's great to hear about that. But, you know, as in life, there's ups and downs. What's the most significant setback in your life so far?
I definitely think dad dying and mum becoming paralyzed. And mum becoming paralyzed a little bit more because, and I know anyone who's watching this who has family who's disabled will know this, is that when somebody passes away, after a certain amount of time, it fades. But when somebody becomes paralyzed, the entire family's resources are pooled around this disability and either rehabilitating the person. In my mum's case, that wasn't a possibility. So, you know, getting them settled in a facility, tending to their needs, it becomes an ongoing, it's an ongoing saga for the family. And it still is to this day. You know, I'm currently dealing with how to get back into Australia to visit my mum because she's in a nursing home. And that is the ground zero of where you would not want to bring COVID-19 into. And so it is an ongoing stressor in my life. And so I think that has probably been the most challenging. It tested me on a level that I was naive. I didn't anticipate what leaving the global world, moving to suburbia, taking care of her and having my identity shaken. I didn't realize how painful it was going to be.
Very sorry to hear about your loss and about your mother. Must be very difficult. It's, you know, it takes a lot of time, obviously, energy. Everyone close to you, especially her and your sister as well. So, you know, time is something which is very important. I think you touched upon it earlier. I made a recent podcast comment on time, which is that's the most precious asset that we have. How would you give advice to our, you know, younger audience? How would you talk about time?
So it's interesting when I talk to young people about time and I look back at my concept of time, it was always that I want to be in a race. I should have achieved this by 30. I should have done that. When you live like that with all these shoulds and all these deadlines, like a lot of women have, I should be married by 30. What that actually does is it makes life into a race instead of a marathon. So it makes you less mindful with the everyday moments of your life. Like if you ask me certain incidents in Dubai, I cannot even remember because I was so busy doing so many things, I was not able to be there. So yes, time is precious. Don't waste time. But at the same time, don't be a rush through that time that you can't be mindful and sit in the joy of being alive and in the joy of that moment.
Now, you know, you're obviously, you have a winning mentality, you're a winner. Can you tell us a bit about, you know, what are the traits and what's needed to have a winning mentality?
Wow, I've never thought of it as a winning mentality. I used to say in my 20s, failure is not an option, but I realized that that put a lot of pressure on me. So now I just think that I have limitless mindset. I just did a video on this. I don't know if it's not up on LinkedIn yet, but basically when I was 30, I had to go and get tested for the disease that my mum has. It's a rare genetic disease. Only 600 families in the world have it. And I was scared because it's autosomal dominant. So if your parent has it, you have a 50% chance of having it. And you don't just carry the gene recessively. It is the full expression of the gene. You get the condition, like a Huntington's, for example. And so a lot of people get genetically counseled not to get tested for it. But I, because I have a winning mentality or I'm just brave, I just looked down the barrel of the gun and I got tested. And as I was waiting the 12 weeks for the test results, I was having thoughts. I've decided, you know, on the one hand, if I do have it, then I won't have kids because I don't want to pass down the gene. And if I do have it, I will live more presently and more fully. I'll stop saving my pennies like I'm escaping the apocalypse and moving to Mars. I will actually take more holidays and have more fun. And I would have to also tell somebody I'm dating because having seen what it put mum into, if you were a partner of somebody, you deserve to know because you would have to take care of that person. So these were all the things. And then I thought I would live more fully if I do have it. And if I don't have it, I'll live more fully. I'll have kids. I will take more holidays. Either way I saw it, I'm going to be more mindful, more present and live a more dynamic life if I know. And then when I got the results back that it was negative, my mindset literally, in that moment, I remember sitting there and going, I can now fantasize about old age, getting old with my partner, taking cruises without fear. There was actually a mental block before where I did not even want to imagine my old age because it involved having other people wipe my bottom and, you know, take me, wheel me around a nursing home and forgetting who my children were. You know, this was the old age that I was trying not to think about. And in that moment, I realized, oh, this is a limiting mindset. And when in one test, we can remove the limiting mindset, we become limitless. In that moment, I thought, what else am I being limiting about? And I sat down with a piece of paper and I was like, oh, I kept saying, you know, I'm too old to have a second wind in my career. I'm too short to do this. I used to have all these things. And as a result of that test being negative and being limitless about my life expectancy, I then became much more limitless about everything. So it's literally just a pivot of your mindset. So my biggest advice to a winning mindset is to remove those blocks, because it is just as visceral as getting a test that changes your mindset about your future. You can literally go to all your limiting beliefs and do that same and veto it away.
Anything is possible, Simone. That's the moral of the story. But I mean, one thing I would add to that is, in total agreement with what you just said, my only further advice or comment to that is, because of the fact that anything is possible, it means that tomorrow, you know, you and I might not wake up. Every day, 400,000 people don't wake up the next day. That's why even more important, whether you have this condition, you don't have this condition, you have cancer, you don't have cancer, you can change things. And at the same time, sometimes life is taken away from you. So you have to appreciate and, you know, make things happen. Otherwise, you know, you don't know how much time you've got left. Anyway, moving on, principles and ethics is important to, you know, us as human beings, also as business people. What kind of principles and ethics do you live by, and how do you uphold and live with them?
So I believe in spreading goodness where you can. So if there's things that you can do, help people, but don't help people to post about it and rave about it. Like, there's a lot of things that I do for charities. I'm doing something now and I don't make it public because I feel that if you do it motivated for that, it erodes something in you. So that's one of my principles and values. Obviously, hard work, we've spoken about. Self-education, constant improvement, we've also spoken about. Filial piety is obviously a huge part of the message that I spread online. Like, everyone knows who my mum is. She's just like a day short of having her own hashtag, but I just don't believe in going that way with her. So filial piety is a really, really big thing. And it's particularly been quite interesting as women my age, particularly public women my age, largely are now having children. And that's not happening for me because I'm still taking care of a 73-year-old in nappies, right? That's still my baby. Those women or men in that same position without children, with elderly parents that they're taking care of, they have really become a support system for me and followers of mine. So it's funny, I didn't realize that that was a value until I realized it was kind of something that divided women at 36 into camps. You're either the women with the kids where the dialogue is about the kids, or you're those of us who are taking care of the aging parents and that's our dialogue. So filial piety is a huge one for me.
It's especially a common denominator for a lot of Asian families because of the culture, that the upbringing that we have. So I agree with you there. Does religion or spirituality influence or affect you in your life, in your daily life?
Yeah, absolutely. I am about to share the story soon. I filmed it the other day, but you know, when my father passed away, I literally was there holding his hand with the rest of the family. And I saw him just kind of exhale. And when his chest depressed, he was gone. Literally, you know, we watch it in movies, but when you see it in front of you, it was a real moment of, oh, this body of ours is just a sack of flesh, you know. And that's also another one of my values that you see a lot, that I really try and talk to women about because of the Instagram era, that your intelligence is so much more important. And I've been a model and done all that rubbish and all that stuff, right? And it just was so immaterial to the person that I am now. So I try, and also that moment also made me realize too that your soul, like nourishing your character, your mind, is much more vital as we move through life than your exterior, because when we just leave that carcass really behind. And I remember the next day going in to see my dad's body, because he was in palliative care at our home, and I touched his hand and he was just cold. And I looked at his face, and he had like a beauty spot here, and I looked at his face and the beauty spot was still there, and it was still my dad, but it just wasn't him. Like, I knew immediately, this is not my dad. This is just a shell. The warmth, the soul, the expression, everything was gone. And for me, that the part that I am keen to honor is always people's insides, people's souls, people's minds. Like, that's the part of people I want to see showing up in the world the best they can. And also, it was very obvious for me that that soul goes somewhere. Like, when we talk about spirituality, who created this idea that a soul inhabits this flesh, and then when it goes, this becomes an inanimate object? I think when you see someone die right in front of you, that is really drummed in. Like, wow, it's literally like someone got a piece of clay and breathed life into it. And I don't know whether that's God or Allah or Buddha or whoever else anyone believes in, but something is definitely happening in the universe that is far beyond our explanation and the vocabulary that we have for it.
I agree. I had similar experience when my father passed away as well. It's just quite strange when you see him as you used to, and then afterwards it's just, it's not him, but it is him kind of thing. It's another topic we have to talk about.
But Patrick, don't you think it's also probably the most intimate moment you could have with a person? To be there in their last breath, it's profoundly intimate.
Absolutely. I mean, I'll tell you my story. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to be by my father's side. So my father had cancer. He was diagnosed maybe like 6 months before he passed away. He did all chemo. I've flown him around to Taiwan, China, Hong Kong, to the UK. And eventually he passed away in the UK. So on the day that he actually passed away, it was actually one of my companies that I actually listed, IPO'd in London on the London Stock Exchange. And my father was very proud of my work. He was always supportive of my academic and my career throughout my career. And he couldn't speak towards the last 1 or 2 months, but he could like blink his eyes to acknowledge that he knows yes or no. So I really wanted not to go, but my mother wanted me to go. She said, you know, you shouldn't stay. And then I asked my father, you know, should I go or should I not go? And he insisted that I have to go. So I took the flight from Belfast to London in the morning. It was only a 1 hour flight, 90 minutes. So I got off the plane, immediately switched on my phone, you know, texted my brother, and I said, you know, is that okay? And then on the call, my brother said, oh, you know, he's not good. I think he's going. So I said, okay, let me speak to him. So we put it on speaker. So I told him, like, Dad, I just arrived in London. We're going to do the IPO today. I know you're listening. You know, did my whole thing. I love you, all that kind of stuff. So whole family's there, a lot of relatives. And after I spoke, and then he went. And then everyone's obviously crying and stuff. So even though I wasn't there, it was I don't regret it, because it was just something that I think he would have wanted me to do. Mm-hmm. And obviously I did it. It was a tough experience. And then as soon as the thing went, I went back to the next day and we did his whole funeral and stuff. So
also, as a Chinese man, your father probably didn't want you to see him like that. There is an element of that, you know, culturally, that he doesn't want you to see him in that moment, maybe.
Yeah, so. Absolutely. That's definitely part of it. It's, you know, it's part of life. You know, it's, you know, I've moved on, I've said at the time, but, you know, again, I go back to the time, you know, analogy is that life is so precious that we have to make use of every second, every minute. And then it's not because of scaring of dying. Like you say, it's just a vehicle that we're in right now. But, you know, we get to make a lot of friends, family, connections, and it's enjoying the moment because it could be taken away from you at any moment. And as soon as you sort of like realize and come to terms of that, you lead a bit, you know, happier and better life.
Yeah.
You know? Okay. So what about your, personally, I don't think you've reached the peak of your career yet. You're still on, you know, a good trajectory, but up to now, what do you think is the single most important factor in your journey so far?
Oh, I think it's an addiction to growth. So when I was younger, when I told you about grit and ambition, it was almost toxic. Like, I would work to the point of exhaustion, to the point that I could barely be pleasant with people because I had insomnia and I'd be snappy and all of those things. And you know how important human connection is to me. And I realized that there's got to be a better way. And then I went to like a Tony Robbins seminar and he said something to me. He said, as human beings, we're happier in the growth than we are with achieving the goal. So for me, it's how do I continue the growth? And you're right when you say I'm not at the peak. That's why I'm so happy right now, because I know that the trajectory is ascent, but I'm not there yet. And that's actually the happiest part. And when I remind myself of that, I can sit in the journey better and enjoy the journey better. Like I'm writing the book at the moment, doing the podcast. And I actually tell myself, like, you'll never write your first book again. So you better sit in this and enjoy this process instead of just trying to race to the end to have the glory of holding this book, which is what I was like in my 20s. So I think have an addiction to growth, because the growth is actually a swappable word. It's a synonym for happiness.
So what about life ethos? What's your life ethos, Simone?
We are here for connection. I know this is, we're talking about success and all of this achievement stuff, but actually the stories that I've told you today, the ones that you'll remember from this podcast episode are the stories about my family and my sister and my friends and my partner, because your brain is wired to detect connection between me and Patrick, between you watching. Connection is what we're here for. It's how our brains are neurologically wired, and human beings are the most social creatures on the planet. So in all this conversation about the journey and achieving and growth and all of these things, please don't sacrifice your connections on the way, because you'll just reach the pinnacle of success and it will be empty without connection.
So Simone, we only have two more questions left. The second last question is, what's the next big thing for Simone?
So last year was all about hustling to survive. This year, it's all about doing projects I love. So for example, with my coaching clients, I'm only taking on three for the whole year so that I can write the book. The book, I want it to be a book that I can be proud to put my name against, you know, not anything. I have to do it within 12 months, my agreement with the people publishing it, but put my heart into it, make it the most resonant, the most something I'm proud of. Because sometimes speaking books are not, you know, they can be just rushed as a commodity, right? I want it to be something I'm really proud of. And this podcast with Audible, we were part of an accelerator creating content for Audible Asia. And we just got through to the next round. And so I'm really excited to see whether we can, from this commissioned pilot, whether we get through to the stage where they commission a full series of this human connection podcast, which is super, super exciting, because for me, having been in audio for years, doing mediocre daily work, because obviously any work that you churn out daily, it's not going to be amazing. But I want now to be able to do just quality and not quantity and make them incredible audio documentary on human connection, just like something you'd watch on Netflix, but in audio. And so those are the two major things that really, really excite me, because I realize the rest of it, Patrick, the speaking engagements, the hosting gigs, the endorsements, or this, that, they will all come. And if I look back at 15 years of my life, they've all just come and gone in rotation, right? And there's something that's incoming. I can't really control that, but I can control the quality of the work that I'm putting out. So yes, that's what I'm super excited about that.
The last question is always on Anything Is Possible is, Simone Heng, can you share your number one advice to our audience, especially our younger audience?
So my number one advice to you as somebody who studies human connection is, I know you guys love the phone. I'm on TikTok. I know that the phone is a thing. The phone is a thing for me too. But at some point we have to put it away and we have to learn to reconnect with the tribe and reconnect with the people around us and be with the people around us and be mindful. And that's very hard to say to people who've grown up digital. Patrick, I had an analog childhood and a digital adulthood, and I have believe that the nuances of how I connect with people, my charisma or whatever, is because of that analog childhood without that phone. But in a future where we will have AI and digital transformation, the number one thing that you can do to get ahead, if that's what you want to do, is to nurture your humanness. And part of your humanness is how well you connect with other humans. And you do that by being vulnerable, talking about deep subjects, looking people in the eye, giving people your full attention, all of those things. So please just try and detox from the phone a little bit and live in person with your connections versus through the phone.
Simone, thank you for your time. It's been great talking to you. I think we can, you know, talk endlessly. There's just so many topics. We didn't have enough time to talk about everything. But definitely, when restrictions allow us, I'll definitely come and see you in Singapore, and we can catch up.
Yeah. Please, I'm not just showbiz saying that. I mean that, Patrick. I think we've got so much in common. So please, and to anyone who's watching, if you need anything, please just DM me.
Yes. Simone, it's been absolute pleasure. We're going to share all Simone's links. Watch her, listen to her. She's the greatest in the human connection specialist. I'm trying to catch up to her. It'll take some time. But thank you for joining us. And we'll look forward to seeing everyone soon. Stay safe and stay healthy.
Thank you, Patrick.
Thank you, Simone. Anything is possible.